What's going on, guys? Wade here, the Millennial Stone Cleaner. We're out to repair another monument. This particular monument, at some point in time, fractured. Now, this is an interesting fracture, not something that you would typically see that dramatic without some kind of outward motion on it, you know, a tree or something like that. But even still, it's an interesting fracture. I would have expected it to have fractured down here, just fallen over. So what I can tell from this is that there was, at one point in time, somebody did a repair on this and put a Portland cement-based product here. I can kind of see it there in the joint. Down here is loose, so I'm going to leave that intact as long as this holds up. We're going to clean the surface up. There was a previous repair there. We'll take care of that, and we'll get this back up and going.
This is the grave of somebody from a famous family who remained a mystery for quite some time after I had completed this project. It took some really sophisticated technology to discover her identity.
So I'm just digging around because I can see some pieces of the base that they use as a foundation over here. So I'm gonna dig around and see what I can find on this side to see how far those extend and if we can use some of that or what's going on underneath here. So the good news is that left to right, it's level. It's just this back to front part. So that'll help us out a bit.
Sophia Connell Sherman was born in 1818 and married James Sherman of Lancaster, Ohio. James's father was Charles Sherman, an attorney and state Supreme Court justice. Unlike his brothers, Mansfield, Ohio lawyer Charles T. Sherman, Civil War General William Tecumseh Sherman, who had the Sherman tank named after him, Senator John Sherman from the Sherman Antitrust Act, newspaperman and mayor of Des Moines, Iowa, Lamson P. Sherman, an army paymaster and politician, Major Hoyt Sherman, James never rose to greatness.
Okay, well, that's perfect.
Sophia followed James to Des Moines, Iowa, and together they had four children, Charles, Francis, Hoyt, and Mary. James was a lifelong alcoholic, which brought intense turmoil and financial troubles to the family with failed businesses and debt. I share that respectfully as I myself struggled with an Adderall addiction 10 years ago. His brothers tried frequently to patch up the marriage and offer him jobs. And while the couple never divorced, James did accept a job from his brother John, and he moved to Cincinnati for work while Sophia and the four children stayed behind. James died not that long after from the effects of alcoholism.
I'm going to use a full unit of this putty. This is very toppleable, so I want to make sure that they've got a good bond here. this has been here a long time, so I want to make sure that I get this nice and clean. So just gonna use this on it. We would use normally a manual wire brush on this. This is fine as well, but we want to get this really clean and get off any loose material.
It's important doing any conservation work to have clean surfaces, and that's what we're doing here. The headstone has been broken for so long and these surfaces exposed that there was going to be very fine particles of grains of marble on the surface that are loose, and we need to make sure that we have a clean surface that's strong. So we have to remove the old epoxy bond as well as any loose material that's there, and that's what you see here. If I didn't clean the surface with a wire brush, the bond would ultimately fail. I'm setting up for a blind pin repair. It's a highly technical repair, placing a basalt pin on the inside of the monument. I felt the need for this given the strong angle of the fracture and previous failures of the epoxy. This will also have an epoxy support, but the pin will backstop it. Typically, pinning is not recommended, as if it does fail, it causes significant secondary damage that is almost unrepairable. You can see this type of damage walking around cemeteries and looking at smaller, thin, 2-inch marble tablets, and frequently it's a repair that was done and was done not knowing the consequences of it. We know now the consequences of pinning, and it can be challenging, but given the width of the stone and the depth, I felt it was reasonable. You can see the generally blank face of this headstone as I'm working here. I didn't know who it was, and I just knew that it needed to be repaired, and I was happy to do that. I reached out to Andrew Perrin from the Instagram channel, I Shrew You a Mystery. He's a gentleman who helps others read headstones. You see, he developed his own computer program that's a mix of a commercial program, which lets you turn pictures into 3D models, but then he written his own program, which takes the 3D model and extracts the carvings from the surface. We used over 96 different overlapping photos to come up with a computer rendering of this. His code is estimating where the uncut surface of the stone would have been, and determining from that how deep the carving is at each point. It also straightens the stone and removes the curvature or the warping from the uncut surface. You can see from this stone that it does have a bowl effect to it, which was challenging in this example. From there, we took guesses on what came out of the computer program and used a standard search engine to match the name. It created just enough readability that it allowed us to guess some of the letters, and once we had enough letters that we were confident in, we were able to cross-reference that with cemetery records. The cemetery records were actually inaccurate. They didn't indicate the burial at this location, and so we weren't able to locate that based upon the standard records. So without the computer program and Andrew, this would have not been possible.